Hi. Good morning, or afternoon, or evening, where you may be located. Greetings. Welcome to the Hypercast, Hyperic's bi-weekly series of educational webcasts focused on Hyperic HQ and enterprise systems management best practices. My name is John Mark Walker, and I'm the community manager for Hyperic. We hope you enjoy this Hypercast and consider attending future Hypercasts. The format of the Hypercast will be simple. The main presenter will speak for approximately 30 minutes, followed by a question and answer period. So HQ Full Throttle, why do we want to do this? What I'm going to go through in this Hypercast is the Node GRE installation bundle, as well as the source installation, building from source, and in addition to that, how to do things like enable plugins, how to integrate with Nagios, things that come up from time to time and people seem to want answers to. There are many reasons why we'd want to install with a Node GRE bundle. Hyperic offers several bundles for its HQ product. We offer platform bundles for 8 different server platforms and 8 different agent platforms, and they all seem to work pretty well for if you want to just get something running and installed fairly quickly. However, if you want to scale beyond a certain number of devices, if you have a specific version of a GRE that you need to have installed, or if you have a platform that is not yet supported by HQ Server, these are all reasons why you'd want to use the Node GRE bundle, which is offered with every release of Hyperic HQ. And just as a reminder, the Node GRE bundle is actually it is what it sounds like. It's a bundle that does not include the GRE with it. You have to have a GRE already installed. It also does not include a database. So by definition, we should probably rename it, but the Node GRE version, not only does it mean that it doesn't come with the GRE, but it also means it does not have a bundled database. You have to have a working database as well. And we'll go through that in a moment. The intended audience for this webcast is someone who has installed a bundle before. You're familiar with HQ on a basic level. You've gotten it running, but you don't know a whole lot about the intricacies of how it works, nor do you know how to go beyond just a simple bundle. If you want to know about other HQ options, installation options, scripting options, Nagios integration, and installing from source, this session is intended for you. This presentation is not about high availability, clustering, or scaling, either horizontally or vertically. That's actually for the topic that will be covered in the next Hypercast on November 6th. So using the Node GRE bundle, and again, you'll find this in every release version of Hyperic HQ. It's the same installer as other HQ bundles. It will just ask you, you just have to make sure you have your Java home variable set. And again, I'll walk through this in the demo in a moment. The officially supported versions are Sun's official JRE, that's 1.4.2, 1.5, and the recent Java 6. Actually, JRE 6 is not officially supported, but customers reported it works, and I'm actually going to use it in this demo, so it actually works fairly well. However, until we go through more testing with it, we can't officially support it. With the release of Hyperic HQ 3.2, we expect to add it to the list. If you have any issues with using Java 6, please do let us know. No other JREs are supported at this time. That includes the free ones such as Cafe or GCJ. I'm not sure about IBM's Java implementation. If you get any of these to work, and if they require some sort of changes on your part, on your system, please report it to us at on our forums. That's forums.hyperic.com. We would love to hear about it, and we'd love to know about how to get other JREs to work. And without further ado, let's go right into using the Node GRE bundle. The first thing to do is to make sure that I have a database already running, because the installer will need to connect to the database to do the full install. And we can see I have Postgres running. The other thing to check is to make sure I have the Java environment variables set correctly, and I'm using here's the path to my Java 6 installation. And now it's just a matter of running the setup utility, which I'll actually use with the dash full option, because I want to show you sort of what sort of options are available that you don't ordinarily see. And these are just this is actually a standard option that you see on all bundles, including the one I'm installing now. And I actually have a directory already set up here, home johnmark/hyperic. Note that you have to have this directory already, it has to be already created, and you have to have permission to write to it in order for this to work. And now we get into, this is a default option that comes up in every install. As I go through here and just accept the defaults, you'll see other options that don't come up in the normal setup routine. So you can see here, you can set all the ports. We set four different ports for HTTP, HTTPS, JNP, as well as Embed server. This allows you to change your web-based address once it gets running. And I'm just going to accept the defaults here. And then you see here, this is the first major option change for the Node.js version. And I'm going to select PostgreSQL. And this is actually fairly important. I have to change this because I set the database, the database name that I set up is HQ lowercase. And you can see here, it defines the database as HQ uppercase. And I just need to make that small change, and then we'll be ready to go. And I have, again, I've set the database already to accept the username hqadmin, and the password the same. And you can, of course, set this to be whatever you wish. And this is for previous option was the username to connect to the database. This is actually the username to connect to the HQ web portal. This is different, although I'm setting it to be the same thing, HQ admin. And I'm actually setting the password the same. And I'll set the default here. It's not important. And we have three choices: upgrade the database, overwrite the database, exit the installer. I'm actually going to choose overwrite. However, note that if you were upgrading your HQ server, you would certainly choose number one. I want to choose number two and just overwrite the database. Also, if you're upgrading your server, you do want to do the upgrade. If you're upgrading the agent, you actually don't need to worry about that too much. You can just delete the existing agent and install the fresh, the newer version of the agent. Without too much difficulty. All the data is collected by the server, so the agent doesn't retain any information. You can usually, depending on your setup, safely remove the older version and just install the newer version. And it's just asking me if I want to overwrite the HQ database. Yes, I do. And that's correct. Also, and here we go. And it takes a few seconds to get up and running. And there we go. So setup is completed. Everything should be installed now. So I go to my directory that I defined. And it's all there. And if I want to start the server, and everything from here is the same as if you had run any other platform bundle. And that's ready. And now I start the agent. And it'll take a few seconds to connect to the server. Except for that's right. The first time I run the agent, it asks me for where the server is because it has to know. And since this is a local install, I'm going to put localhost. We don't have to worry about secure communications. Default port. And it'll take a few seconds for the HQ server to boot. And while we're waiting for that, I actually have a list of all the various options that you can set in the dash full setup utility using the dash full flag. And when you do that, and I'll have it's in the it's in the slides I have here, and I'll post it along with the archive of this Hypercast once I get everything together, and that will be available within 24 hours after this is finished. And I log in. Yes. And we're off. And if you've installed the basic bundle, this is pulling up the web portal is exactly the same thing. But we'll go ahead and test just to make sure. Not that one. The other one. There we go. So and here's the portal. And we're logged in. And I'll just add all of this stuff to our inventory. And there's your basic setup. But what do we do from here? I'll go back to the slides for a second. And just an overview of the different flags that are available in setup, because sometimes if you're going to do something beyond just a simple bundle installation, you need to know, what sort of database flags are supported. Is an upgrade? Do you need to use the full flag? These are all available. So the five flags available are full, upgrade, Oracle, PostgreSQL, MySQL. The last three require that you have a database set up, ready to go, and running already. And note that the MySQL here, the flag here, is strictly experimental. Many things don't quite work yet, but with the HQ 3.2 release, which will be in a couple months, that should be vastly improved. So that's something to look forward to. And of course, if you wish to install from our Subversion source code repository and help us with that, that would be great. And here's a list of the dash full options that you can set. I apologize for formatting. Unfortunately, the slides wouldn't allow me to put it into a double column format. However, I promise that when I put the archive up tomorrow, I'll put these in more legible format. Also note that you can get all this information from the URL at the top of this list. It's on our support wiki, and I'll also post that as well on the archive. And I want to call attention also to the authentication data source. By default, it's the HQ database, but you can actually set that to be an LDAP server, which is pretty nice. And there's another URL for that where you can get all the information for that option. Sometimes you just need to build from source. There are a variety of reasons for that. And I'll just go quickly through. I've actually installed a source. I just completed a source install before this call because the building process itself would take too much time to cover. But I do want to go over what it would take to get that running. Again, you would need to have a database set up and ready to go. You do need a JDK as opposed to the bundle install. Even the Node.js install, we're pretty much limited to one JDK, and that's Java 1.4.2 from Sun. Personally, I haven't gotten it to work with Java 1.5. If you have experienced otherwise, do let us know in the forums. Again, there's a URL here that gives you all the instructions for installing from source. And as I mentioned, you need JDK 142. We actually base our build environment in Ant. Actually, Maven is wrong there. And we also deploy in a JBoss application environment. The first thing to do is to make sure your system variables are set. There are five, and in my case, since the Ant I have on my system is the default that comes with Ubuntu, I don't have to worry about the Ant home variable. But Java home variable, definitely need to make to check that. So if I do, actually, my Ant options are set as they're supposed to be. And if I check my Java home directory, that's set to the JDK 142 as it's supposed to be. And if I want to check my Java options, that is correct. And that's basically it. Next, we go into how you need to tailor the build environment to your particular installation. Before I do that, let me stop the running HQ. Okay, that's done. So note that you have to edit the build.properties file, and that's located in your within your source tree in a subdirectory at C, etc. And you have a list here of five things at a minimum that needs to be set in that file. So we look here, and we have the JDBC URL, the right driver. In this case, we're using PostgreSQL. You could also set it to be Oracle. The user and password on this slide are set to HQ. You'll see where I have mine set a little bit differently. Everything else should work. So if I look at, so I'm in my source tree here. I go into etc, build properties. They're all set as so. If you look at this section is the important one. You'll see where I actually have my user and password set to hqadmin. Which you'll know from, you'll remember from the Node.js install we just did. And everything should be set. And there are five steps in the build process itself, all Ant commands. There's probably to automate this. I'm not going to go into all of them. Just know that it actually doesn't take very long to build. On my MacBook, it takes about, you know, maybe 10 minutes, if that long, actually. Although it is a different process for actually starting the server once you complete building. Because once you deploy it on a working JBoss server, it's a matter of just starting up the JBoss server, and then it will deploy the HQ web app. And that's from source. So now that I've gone through that, let me start up the server and agent that I installed before. Let me start those up again. I was going to run the JBoss deployment, but for time constraints, I'll just avoid that for now. Just know that it's a different process to run HQ server from after building it from source and deploying on a working JBoss application server. Okay, so that's started. Now I start the agent. And because it already, when I ran it the first time, you'll note that it asked for a bunch of things about where to find the HQ server. Because I already ran that once and it saved information, it knows where to find the HQ server now. And let's go back to our dashboard. And we'll probably have to log in again. Yes. Okay. One of the more common questions we get is, how do I get a new plugin to work? How do I deploy it? What is it going to look like? Where do I find it after it's deployed? And that sort of thing. And again, here's a URL for your reference. But just know that when we release every version of Hyperic HQ, we have bundled plugins, some of which are in an example directory and some of which are in the working directory. If it's in the working directory, it's available by default. If it's in the example directory, you actually have to move it from there into the working directory. And I show the two locations here. You have to deploy the plugin in both of these locations. You can't just deploy it on the agent. You also have to have it on the agent as well as the server in the directories shown here. And I'm actually going to do that now. Most people start up HQ and ask, so how do I do a ping? Because one of the most common plugins to use with Nagios is the ping plugin. And we actually have an ICMP ping plugin. And if I go into the directory here and I look at the examples, I see, in fact, ping-plugin.xml. All I have to do is copy this plugin and put it into plugins directory. And after that, then I need to go into the server directory. And let's look back. And I need to go right here. So again. And just a moment while I copy this in the second location. And once you do this, the server supports hot deployment, meaning that you can put in a new plugin and it should automatically deploy without restarting. However, the agent does not support that. So let's restart the agent. Great, so we have a plugin deployed. So where is it? That's a very good question. Most people get to this point and they wonder, they ask that exact question because it's not at all obvious from at least this view where it is. However, if you go into the inventory tab, you'll notice a few options here. And if you scroll down, you will see a lot of different options. You have general properties, type and network properties, servers, services. The ping plugin is a service. In our architecture, we define four different layers of the data center. There's platform, server, service, and application. A server is like the Apache web server, JBoss application server. A service would be one of the services that run on top of a server. So in the case of Apache, it would be a vhost. In the case of JBoss, there are all sorts of deployed web apps. Those are services. And we also define the ping plugin, or ICMP ping, as a platform service. So if we go into our services and we hit new, let's just name it new ping, and we look at service type, scroll down, and there you'll see ICMP ping. It wasn't actually available before. I probably should have shown that before I installed it, but trust me on this, it was not available before. Okay. And now we have a new ping service, except it doesn't know where to ping, so we have to define that. If you go into configuration properties, edit, and for one thing, this path is actually not correct. On my system, it's actually Ben ping, not SBen. We have a host name that will ping, and we'll switch, and then the account, and then we'll click OK. Now if we go to the monitor, and now this is actually the monitor screen for the newly deployed ping plugin. So here's a plugin that was not operational before. We just defined it, we deployed it, defined it, and now it's working, and it will take probably a couple minutes for the data to show up. We have the collection interval at every 5 and 10 minutes. 5 minutes will get you a response time, every 10 minutes to show availability, so it'll take a few minutes for it to show up. But now it is at least operational. Let's see. One other thing a lot of people will ask is, so how do you use, so I have Nagios running. How do I integrate that with HQ? And we do actually have a means for people to do some level of integration with Nagios. And let me go through that now. Here is the platform view for the platform that we imported when we first installed the bundle. And you'll see a list of things here. You'll note that Nagios is not among the things that was auto-discovered. So let's go back to our inventory panel. And when we go back here, we see our servers. And Nagios is defined as a server. So we'll simply hit new and define it here. And under server type, we'll scroll down, and there's Nagios. And I actually have all of my Nagios configuration files in etc/nagios, so we'll go there. And it is now defined. And note something under configuration properties. It actually lets you define where your Nagios config file is, and it has a little check mark here for auto discover plugins. And this allows you to import existing Nagios plugins so you can use them with your HQ deployment. And this path name, I have to edit it because mine is actually /nagios/nagios.cfg. So I'll set that here. And now when I go to monitor, you'll see it discovered services by type Nagios plugin. Let me see what that service is. And you'll see just now it imported this plugin. It's the Nagios plugin, the ping. If I go into that service, I can actually change the configuration properties for this Nagios plugin. And let's change what it pings. Let's, just for the sake of doing something quickly, we'll make the host a local host. And everything else should be set correctly. Actually, the path name and everything else was imported from the plugin itself, so that should be fine. And there we've defined a Nagios server that was already existing on this machine, and we imported the plugin, and now we can actually monitor that plugin. So if you look at, if I go back to the platform, and I look at my monitoring view, and I see what's available here. I'll see Nagios stuff, which was something we just defined. And actually have availability for the my defined Nagios server. It's probably not collecting information yet, but it will very shortly. And you can see it's actually done an availability check. And if I go into my Nagios server, I have the ping plugin, which has not yet been run. If I highlight the ping plugin and I select it, I now have these three metrics that are defined by the plugin, which I can now bring into my indicator view. And actually, you can see it is already gathering data. availability, execution time, and return code. And considering that we're pinging localhost, that's not too much of a surprise. And that's that. So those are two. So as far as plugins go, I just showed you deploying a new plugin, and also showed how to access a plugin that doesn't do auto-discovery. The Nagios server was not auto-discovered, but you can define it manually from your platform view. Adding metrics. Most of the time, people will install HQ, and they'll wonder how to enable new metrics. And I'll just go through that very briefly. The important thing to remember is you go to your administration screen. There's a monitoring defaults link. And this is actually, if you have not read the test ride guide, which is available for download as a PDF from our website, you really should. It will go into this in more detail. But basically, regardless of what you're monitoring, you simply look at the link for edit metric template. And note that, and it gives you a warning, modifying the collection interval will overwrite the current collection intervals of existing metrics. So if you have modified your collection intervals to be a certain number of minutes, this will certainly override that. And as you look down the list, you'll see things that are enabled by default, their collection intervals, and as well as whether or not they appear in your indicator view. And you can change all of that from here. And that's really all there is to say about that. Once you enable it here, you can go back to the monitoring view. And you would enable it under your metric data tab. You would say show all metrics. And if we had enabled new ones, you would see them start to appear here. Okay. Just a couple notes on agent permissions. The server will not allow you to run as root. The agent will allow you to run as root. We certainly don't recommend that, although sometimes it is necessary, but usually not. If you're checking logs of a particular server that you're monitoring, remember that those logs have to be viewable by the user that you're that is running the agent. Also, you can set if you're monitoring a server, you can set it to use sudo, and I'll show you briefly how I did that from the web interface. So if I go into my sudoers file, you'll see where I defined my user to be able to get root privileges without providing a password, and that's the no password option. After the no password option, you'll see where I defined all. That means I can execute everything on the system as root. That's probably not the best thing to do. However, after the no password flag here, I can define all of the executables that I want to run as with root privileges without giving access to the entire system, and that's probably the best way to do that. Once I do define that, it's a matter of just simply going to a specific server, let's say our Apache server, and if I wanted to go to the inventory tab and under configuration properties, under the control section, there's a field for prefix, and if I wanted to be able to control my Apache server, if I wanted to be able to restart it, stop it, that sort of thing, I could simply just put sudo, some people pronounce it differently, in that field, and then that would allow me to do that with root privileges while running the agent as a non-root user. So that's that's a pretty helpful tip. I wish I'd known that the first time I was installing HQ. And that's basically it. So, if you have any questions, I've run a little bit long here, but we'll have about 20 minutes left over for questions. If you have any, please use your chat applet. and then I will tabulate them and answer them as quickly as possible. Let me take a brief pause for about a minute while I go over questions, and then I'll come back and answer them for the next 20 minutes. Thank you. Hi, and we actually have a question about using Nagios plugins. And basically the question is, can you actually use a Nagios plugin as a plugin? And that gets, it's a little bit difficult. The integration is will certainly improve going forward, and definitely in HQ 3.2, which again will be out in a couple of months. But it currently we allow you to import the plugin. It runs the plugin. But if you want to actually retrieve data, there's actually an XML file that you'll need to edit, and that gets into plugin development and defining the data within an XML file, and that's probably a subject for another Hypercast, which we'll have fairly shortly, because developing plugins is actually rather simple, but it is beyond the scope of this Hypercast. However, having said that, as I demonstrated, you can certainly import the plugin and at least run them, but it requires a little bit more configuration to get it to return data. And the same goes really for any script that you run. Actually, let me go through. Let's get to the same platform inventory screen that I showed you earlier where I enabled the Nagios plugin. If I go back to the inventory tab and I look at services, and we have the ping service that we enabled a few minutes ago. And if I wanted to enable, let's say I have a script on my system that I want to run, that I want to use sort of as a quasi plugin, I guess. And I'll just call this random script. And you can see within the pull down for service types, you know, among all these other things, which really give you a lot of options in terms of agentless monitoring. If I then choose the script service type, and then under configuration properties, I can define where the script lives. It's fairly easy to define a script that you can run via this mechanism. However, if you wanted to return data and actually pull data and store it in the database and all that good stuff, you'll need to define an XML file, and that's in the Plugin Development Center, which is another link that I will be happy to include with the archive so that you can see that. And that's basically that. Okay, well, thank you for attending. I hope this has been helpful for you. Again, I will post the entire archive on our website at hyperic.com/demo/hypercasts.html, and I'll also include all the URLs that I went over here. Okay, thank you for attending. Bye.